Peter Taylor returned 5 years and four managers later. The star players had long gone. Derby were bottom of Division 2.
All I know is that their current position is diabolical, and somebody, somewhere, hasn't been pulling their weight. Well, it's my job to find out who those people are immediately. So that's the immediate job. Who's with us, who's against us, etc., etc. That's the first job.
But now Coffle, right side, far side. This is the best chance of the match, and it's made the count.
Despite that cup defeat, Taylor kept Derby in the second division for a season. He made wholesale changes, losses on transfers, but reached the FA Cup quarter-final next season at lowly Plymouth.
Useful. Good try in! Off the post now! Amazingly!
With that sort of luck, the replay at Derby looked like a formality.
Chuzel is on the near post, comes away, and Cherry in trouble! It's straight in!
It wasn't as bad as what people made it out to be. I think on the field it wasn't too bad, but off the field it was a bit of a disaster. The players weren't getting wages. You know, we're going up there 4 or 5 weeks not getting wages. I was lucky because I had a very understanding bank manager. But a lot of the players had a lot of problems.
Then more problems, relegation to Division 3, the sack for Peter Taylor. Derby's last real chance of avoiding the drop evaporated at Newcastle. The home team had every incentive to crush the Rams. They were after promotion to Division 1. Newcastle won so easily, Derby might have done better to stay away. The man in charge of the scoreboard apparently thought they had. He forgot to put up the visitor's name. It was a telling comment on a football club in desperate circumstances. They faced a winding-up order in court, could only trade on memories and hope a millionaire would bail them out.
They were on in the knacker's yard. The directors had exhausted all of their resources. They were hugely in debt. They'd lost millions of pounds. A really very sad story for what has been one of the great clubs of England and Europe.
I had firm belief this club had a future, certainly had a past, and I was convinced that with the supporters we got, there's only one way forward. And I put everything behind it, and I think it's proved the point today, hasn't it? Back to the First Division.
Stuart Webb stuck firm to the belief that the club could be saved, and he always looked at what had been done in the past and felt that that made it a very good club to sell to somebody. And eventually he found someone who was prepared to buy in the Maxwell family. A lot of creditors were able to say, well, look, all right, I'll accept 50p in the pound. Directors made phenomenal further sacrifices to cut what they owed to the club. And eventually a package was rushed into the High Court with about 5 minutes to spare.
Ian Maxwell, son of Robert, bought Derby County. He bought it from Stuart Webb, who'd bought it from the directors. Maxwell appointed Webb, once club secretary, to be its managing director. Webb, a football fanatic as well as a shrewd businessman, had already hired a manager. Arthur Cox, the man whose team had dumped Derby into Division 3, had fallen out with Newcastle. He'd been promised a rise. The rise was slow in coming. Webb moved in.
I'd seen him before, I'd seen him work with players, and when he was in dispute with Newcastle over his contract, I couldn't believe the luck. So we dived in and he managed to persuade him to come down. And that again was a major significant point in the turning of Derby County's fortunes.
When we came, there was nine players were signed. One was already leaving, and the other two we had to discuss their contracts with them. So that's what we started with. And from there we've worked and brought players in and bullied them and encouraged them, and well, here we are, we've got them into the First Division, haven't we?
Cox's first match was in the Third Division. Conscious of the costly mistakes of the past, the board told him to pick up players on the cheap. He bought half a dozen for the price of a family car. The rest of the staff he inherited from Peter Taylor. Roy McFarland, assistant manager, was among them. His backing earned Cox early goodwill in the city. The team had many players who'd seen better days. That day at Bournemouth, they lost, but they did try, and they played with pride, in front of thousands who'd travelled down from Derby. They were eternal optimists, fiercely loyal, glad to have a team at all. They soon made Derby the wealthiest club the Third Division had seen in ages. She changed her hairstyle. One young man went even further.
Well, I said, yeah, I changed my surname from Stack to Derby, and I'm now Mick Derby, like. got a lot of pressure off my folks for it, and you know, my mates thought it was quite interesting. But
why did you do it?
Just a love of Derby County and a pride in the city of Derby. It's as simple as that, you know. My club, my city, stand by them. That's it.
Arthur Cox was given the money to bring in quality players. Among the first, Gary Micklewhite from Queen's Park Rangers for £80,000. Then John Gregory from the same club, £100,000. Phil Gee, a former decorator, came cheaply from non-league soccer. Later, much later, Nigel Callaghan signed from Watford. His fee, £140,000. The expensive imports had First Division skills, First Division habits. Those habits translated into something resembling football, something the crowd hadn't seen since the 70s. Their enthusiasm induced ex-internationals to Derby.
It's difficult really to pinpoint. All I could say really is to the general public here that they actually live for this club. You know, it's the talk of the shop floor on Monday mornings or whatever. It's the talk of the pubs. They've really come along here, as you can see, in the thousands, week in, week out, as they have been for the last 10 years or so when they've had little or no success.
Well, I think money talks, and all footballers, because of the short time they have in a football career, tend to speak the language. And I'm sure that money was made available that compared to what was on offer elsewhere. But I think beyond that, again, there is a certain cachet in the name Derby County. And also, I think people did feel very confident that Arthur Cox was going to bring success.
Success came in Cox's second season. Derby clawed their way out of Division 3 in third place. That was good enough for the city. A civic reception followed. There was no band, no trophy, but the streets were lined all the same. The ghosts of the past were about to be laid. May 1987, Derby had taken Division 2 by storm. All they had to do to achieve promotion to the First Division was to draw with Leeds. 20,000 fans turned up. Those who couldn't get in could hear it on Radio Derby.
Yeah, the ball knocked away and a fine piece of play by G. Gets away from Ormsby, half the length of the field, goes forward, and he scored! What a superb run! Half the length of the field by Phil G. There's a bit of an opening in front of him. Aspen closes it. Lovely ball along the penalty line to Micklewhite. Micklewhite spoons it back. Davison goes in and scores with a header. A move of exquisite construction. There it is. Derby County. Derby County are back in the First Division. Derby County 2, Leeds United 1.
Cox is better than Cluffy, they chanted. Cox himself would have none of it.
To me, the things that he's achieved in football have, you know, my mind pales into insignificance compared with what he's achieved. And obviously, it's a great motivation to me. I mean, to think in terms of trying to do some of the things that he's done.
I don't think it pales into insignificance. What I think possibly Arthur's talking about is he'd like to go on and win First Divisions and get, when we eventually allow back into Europe, he wants Derby back there, and he wants them one of the leading sides in the First Division. That'll be a big job for him. Sometimes it's harder to hang on to success when you've got a little bit than achieving it.
Enter Robert Maxwell, the new Derby chairman. The owner of the Daily Mirror weighed in with headlines about Clough and Forest.
This is traditional rivalry, and big mouth Clough is really should belt up a little. And we will make him hold his tongue by the way Derby knocks him and his team into the ground.
Maxwell has knocked pipes into the ground, paying £140,000 for undersoil heating to stop games being postponed in winter. That's not the only investment. England's goalkeeper came too. Some said £1 million had been spent without Arthur Cox knowing.
I certainly bought him. I negotiated the purchase. Arthur Cox knew everything about him. If Arthur had been at home, he would have participated in the negotiations. But I will make the final decision on whether we buy a player of that calibre and at that price.
We do tend to attract people who are slightly larger than life or think they are. And I think, really, it's going to be a very important factor in Derby's success, whether he is prepared to take a secondary role or whether he wants to be up front calling the shots all the time. I think if he's prepared to leave it to the professionals, to Arthur Cox and to Stuart Webb, to run it as it's been run for 3 years, then the club will carry on and prosper. If he interferes, frankly, then there are great dangers.
Derby police sensed danger and possible disorder in Maxwell's anti-Clough comments. They wrote and asked him to stop. He has.
He did great things for Derby. I have always thought, until a few years ago, that he would have made an outstanding manager for England. He's done great things for Forest, and we shall do our level best to keep all the points when we meet them at Derby and at Nottingham.
So Derby go into Division One a generation after Clough last took them there. Football eventually gave way to mudslinging and politics, which almost destroyed the club. No one wants a repetition.
Well, it won't happen because now we're running as a business. Beforehand, the control in the boardroom was lax. There was split within the board. Managers were spending money the club hadn't got. But now, as I said, we have a solid board, stability right through the club, and we've got a platform to launch this club into first division style.
The club went down because of bad management and rows in the boardroom. We have nothing but good management, and there certainly will be no rows in the boardroom.
Why?
I won't tolerate it.
I can't see there being another boardroom crisis because the board, apart from Maxwell, really has no status, no power. They're almost a social function in the club now. And I think they're enjoying it after all the warfare they've had. Maxwell will only cause a crisis if he decides to interfere personally in the running of the football side of the club and if he encroaches into the role that Arthur Cox decides is his. That's the only possibility, and I hope Maxwell, who is nobody's fool, has the sense to keep clear of that province.
The directors at Derby, and I am not a director's man by any stretch of imagination, but they did write vast amounts of money off. So they have to be given a bouquet saying, well, thanks very much for sticking by the club. Everybody's delighted in the game now, and you should share the glory also. Because there's a lot of clubs where directors don't put a penny in.
We've had a few thin times, you know, but now everyone's revelling in it at the moment, you know. The city's been in a state of euphoria ever since we beat Leeds and we got promoted and that. You know, it's been tremendous, you know. And I don't think it'll really sink in until, like, sort of in the summer when the fixture list is produced, you know, and you're looking for games, you know, when are you playing Arsenal, when are you playing Man U and all this business, you know. Before it was, we used to look at fixture lists and think, oh, how far have we got to go on Boxing Day? How far have we got to go at Easter and all things like that, when the trains aren't running and you're struggling for transport and that. But now it's you're looking at some of the, you know, you're in the big time. That's it. Derby County are back in the big time.